Leamington Spa Airfield, sometimes referred to as Bishop's Tatchbrook, Whitnash or Bonniksen's Airfield, was the brainchild of Major Julius Edward Bonniksen. Before presenting this potted history of the airfield, I'd like to start by saying that Bonniksen's life could, I think, make for an interesting story in itself. From having been interned by Germany, accused of being a spy at the age of only 17, just as World War I began, to his achievements during that war and on to the building of his airfield and also to other business enterprises. However, I shall leave that for others to consider. After having managed to return to England from Germany following his adventure, or rather nightmare, between July and September 1914, Bonniksen immediately enlisted as a private in the kite balloon section of the Royal Engineers. Bonniksen soon transferred to the Royal Flying Corps as a second class air mechanic, and he qualified as a pilot in 1916. By August 1917, he was serving in France with number 42 Squadron, flying the RE-8 aircraft. He then went on to serve on the Italian front until March 1918. During the First World War, Bonniksen became a squadron leader and earned numerous medals of gallantry, including the Silver Medal for Military Valour, which was awarded to him by the King of Italy. He attained the rank of Major in 1919. Around 1920, while Bonniksen continued to fly, he chose to leave what had by then become the Royal Air Force to earn a living by working with his father, Bahne Bonniksen. Originally from Denmark, Bonniksen's father was apprenticed as a watchmaker. He moved to Coventry, England, where he set up a factory and is famous for inventing the Karussel watch mechanism, which was adopted universally. Bahne Bonniksen diversified his knowledge of horology into other timing devices, including an automatic gas lighter for street lamps. However, he is universally famous for his conception and patenting of his isochronous speedometer for cars and motorcycles. I am most grateful to Steve Knight for providing these images from Rotherham's of Coventry. Whilst working for his father, Julius Bonniksen published a brochure advertising their tachometers for aeroplanes. Inspired by Sir Alan Cobham's campaign to set up aerodromes around the country, in 1931, Bonniksen decided to buy 4 fields southeast of Leamington Spa off Harbury Lane. Bonniksen's vision was to set up an aircraft park and flying school, which would also become one of a chain of aerodromes serving key towns and cities around the country. The airfield's location in relation to Leamington Spa was here. Bonniksen's Airfield opened in 1932. In July 1932, Bonniksen constructed a hangar for his de Havilland Gypsy Moth. He intended to use his aircraft for flying tuition and taxi work. In April 1933, Bonniksen applied for permission for two additional hangars and a bungalow. By September 1933, Bonniksen and his family were living here. The bungalow also served partly as a clubhouse. According to a witness I spoke to, the bungalow was only recently demolished and the site redeveloped. Current Google Map images do still show the old bungalow. In May 1933, there were two flying circus events. The British Hospital's Air Pageant and Sir Alan Cobham's National Aviation Day display. The National Aviation Day event over the 13th and 14th of May 1933 included Jim Mollison, who brought in King Edward VII's granddaughter, the Princess Arthur of Connaught, in his de Havilland Hawk Moth. In April 1934, Bonniksen established the Leamington Spa and Warwickshire District Aero Club. His Gypsy Moth, registered Golf Alpha Alpha Foxtrot India, was the first aircraft. The club had three other Gypsy Moths registered to it, including this particular one. This photograph was taken at Leamington Spa in 1934. In 1934, two additional buildings were erected along with two petrol pumps situated adjacent to Harbury Lane. Unfortunately, the pumps were not used very much because of a lack of patronage. In June 1934, Sir Alan Cobham appeared again to support Bonniksen's enterprise. Unfortunately, on the 11th of November 1934, Bonniksen's Gypsy Moth crash-landed on the airfield. Thankfully, no one was hurt. Bonniksen's vision to set up his aircraft park and flying school appeared to be short-lived. Fortunately, Bonniksen was able to acquire more capital to continue, and on the 1st of January 1935, a new Leamington and Warwick District Aeroplane Club was established. The club's first annual air display, in conjunction with the British Junior Car Club, was on the 7th of April 1935. Lord and Lady Willoughby de Broke flew their BA Eagle Golf Alpha Delta Echo Sierra into the airfield in support of the new club. On the 18th of April 1936, the British Hospital's Air Pageant returned for an air display at the airfield. Here is Bonniksen in 1937 standing by de Havilland Moth Kilo India, along with the owners of that aircraft, Jack and Mima Profumo. An interesting event at the airfield occurred on the 11th of December 1937. a Hawker Hart from RAF Brize Norton had become lost in fog. Bonniksen saw the aircraft overhead the airfield, and he fired a very flare pistol to alert the pilot. The aircraft landed safely. 1938 saw several aircraft based at Leamington, such as this Clem Golf Alpha Alpha X-ray Kilo. Fairchild F-24 Golf Alpha Echo Charlie Oscar, owned by the disgraced Conservative MP John Profumo, was also based at Leamington. As was Alf Green's unique Dart Pup, Golf Alpha Echo Lima Romeo. The long-distance record breaker, Mr. H.L. Brook, based his Percival Gull, Golf Alpha Delta Zulu Oscar, at Leamington. Miss Joan Parsons' Spartan three-seater, Golf Alpha Bravo Tango Romeo, was also based at Leamington. 1938 also saw Miss Parsons purchase Miles Sparrowhawk Golf Alpha Delta November Lima for a record flight attempt to the Cape in South Africa. Unfortunately, she had to force land only 350 miles short. One of the last air shows to take place at Leamington was the Empire Day display on the 28th of May 1938. The highlight was a flypast by a squadron of Handley Page Hayfords in formation giving low-level bombing runs. It must have been quite a sight. Leading up to World War II, Bonniksen was employed as a flying instructor at Castle Bromwich, Birmingham. Around the time of the outbreak of World War II, Bonniksen was appointed as a pilot officer in the RAF Volunteer Reserve. Both Bonniksen's airfield and bungalow were requisitioned by the War Office soon after hostilities commenced. Unfortunately, by June 1940, Bonniksen had to resign his commission because of ill health. Despite his poor health, Bonniksen changed direction in life and began a farming enterprise. This appears to have successfully sustained him through until 1950, when he sold Bungalow Hill Farm and moved to the Isle of Man, presumably to retire. Bonniksen strikes me to have been a very determined and hard-working man who deserves wider recognition for a number of achievements, not least of which is bringing aviation to Leamington Spa. Shortly after the outbreak of World War II, Leamington's landing ground was extended northwards towards the railway line. The RAF then used Leamington as a relief landing ground and as an emergency landing ground. In particular, the nearby RAF stations at Anstey and Church Lawford used Leamington as an emergency landing ground. After forming at Castle Bromwich Aerodrome in September 1939, No. 14 Elementary Flying Training School moved to Elmden Aerodrome, using such aircraft as this Miles Magister, and used Leamington as a relief landing ground. The aircraft manufacturers Armstrong Whitworth had factories at nearby Coventry, at Whitley and Baginton. They used Leamington for the dismantling, repairing or reconditioning of Whitley, Hampden and Lancaster bomber aircraft. A concreted area was built where aircraft were positioned to check compasses and carry out other general tests. This was still visible when I took these photos on the 12th of November 2021. While the airfield was somewhat underused during World War II, at one stage it was full of Armstrong Whitworth Whitley bombers undergoing repair and testing. It's hard to imagine that scene here in 2021. Did anyone take any photos during World War II? I wonder. Before viewing my other photos and videos which I took on the 12th of November, there is an interesting tale to tell which happened just after the outbreak of World War II. On the 15th of December 1939, one of the largest land aircraft of World War II, the Armstrong Whitworth Ensign, registered Golf Alpha Delta Sierra uniform named UTERP, took off from Coventry Baginton Airfield. It experienced some kind of difficulty and headed to land at Leamington. However, approaching the airfield from the north, it was damaged as it crossed Harbury Lane because of the short field runway. Luckily, UTERP was removed by road and repaired to fly again. This is a photo taken by the RAF in 1948. This shows, firstly, the two Bellman hangars, secondly, the single grass runway, and thirdly, the compass testing platform. In the early 1980s, I visited Leamington and took this photo of what are now the backs of the existing Bellman hangars. At the time, I had no detailed knowledge of the airfield. Had I known, I would have appreciated that I was standing near to Major Bonniksen's wooden office and his hangar, which I believe would have been there. In 2022, the airfield site is occupied in part by Harbury Lane Army Surplus and Warwick Reclamation. What follows now are some photos and a video that I took on my visit to Leamington on the 12th of November 2021. Some video footage starting now, looking north towards the railway line. It's difficult now to imagine aircraft gracing these fields. the World War II runway would be crossing roughly in front of us here, from left to right, or vice versa. Looking back now towards Harbury Lane. I'm panning in now on the compass testing platform. Thanks to my very good friend Keith Brown, I have been lucky to have been able to fly over Bonniksen's airfield a number of times. Thank you very much for watching. I appreciate that old airfield sites are not for everyone. This video is dedicated to Major Bonniksen and to the memories of my parents, who took me to the site of Bonniksen's airfield after visiting Chesterton Windmill 40 odd years ago.